Edmonton! How are you guys doing tonight? Good evening and welcome to the third annual Bloom Festival. Thank you guys so much for being here. My name is Chelsea Bird. I co-host the mornings on 104.9 Virgin Radio, and it is such an honor to be here in this amazing auditorium for such an awesome night, an awesome weekend. Really. Now, we all know why you're here tonight, and I promise in just a few moments we will be bringing out the Marianne Williamson, so sit tight. She's going to be joining us to talk about love as a global force, and if you want more, she's doing the Aphrodite training sessions October 23rd and 25th. You can visit her website, mariannewilliamson.com, for all the details. And following that, another awesome event coming up. MC Yogi is going to be here November 16th at the Art Gallery. You can head to his website for more details on that event as well. First, we want to show some love to our sponsors who joined us here to help make all of this happen, to Lifestyle Meditation, Yoga Life Studio, Lululemon, ID Bohemia, Pura Botanicals, and Glow Juicery. Thank you guys so much. To the Winspear team. There's more, so save your clapping. To the Winspear team, who've been amazing to us, letting us share this space. Thank you so much for being a part of this journey. Bliss Yoga Spa, Jolene Langell Realty, Nourish, Bengal PR, Wellness on White, Integrity Movers. Thank you so, so much. And all the studio partners, yogis, the local community, all of you that came here to be here tonight, give yourselves a huge round of applause. Thank you so much. Now, of course, this is more than just a festival. It's a transformative experience. We asked you to come with an open mind, and you have. So thank you guys so much. Of course, it wouldn't be possible without the creators and founders of this event. So let's bring them out right now. Robindra and Myra, welcome to the stage.
Thank you, Chelsea. We don't normally take stages like this, but here we are. This is 12 months of tireless effort. We got the answer no so many times trying to produce this event, and we finally pushed through. And I'm not sure if you knew, but me and Myra, we got engaged at the very first Bloom in a teepee on the third floor of the Art Gallery, and just recently we got married. So this Bloom is almost like our anniversary. And you guys are here celebrating it with us. You know, we really wanted to bring Marianne Williamson here because she really, for us, she not only, you know, her words are incredible, she's really gonna move you guys today, but she really, what she does in the world is huge. Like her Angel Food Project has fed millions. I think she's talking about 1,000 people a month or a day. I'm not sure the exact number, but it's totally inspiring to see someone not just speak it, but actually do it. And this is what we want Bloom to be about, is let's come here, let's get inspired, and let's go out and take this inspiration and really get our hands in there and do the work ourselves. Personal change is such a, change and transformation is such a personal thing. And it takes for us to actually take action on it, you need to feel like you're in a safe place. And we hope to create a space here that where you feel safe and you feel open, that you can share your dreams with your neighbor, your stranger friend that you just met, or do that Afro-Cuban dance thing that we just did, or the Kundalini yoga with Taylor on the third floor. I mean, we're really asking you guys to stretch your boundaries and really just enjoy with us. We hope you guys can join us tomorrow. We have a full lineup of things that are just as exciting. And without further ado, I want to introduce one of my teachers, Rayanne Woodshot. She had a huge impact on both Myra and myself, and she's going to share a few words. I'm going to give this to Myra real quick, just to put her on the spot. And because I love her.
Thank you, everyone. Truly just heartfelt, overflowing. And I kept my cool this year, so that was big.
And this is her Kundalini gown that she's designed after so many months of, working on it and finally making it come true. So I'm proud of her. Rayanne?
So I just want to take a moment to get your hearts and your minds ready for Marianne. How many of you have ever heard the 100th monkey story? So if you haven't heard the story, I'm going to very briefly share it with you. So there are some that would say it's an urban myth or an urban legend. I like to believe in my life and in my work that sometimes we're encouraged not to believe the impossible so that we can remain somewhat asleep. So it's a story about a group of scientists back in the 50s who were working in Japan studying macaque monkeys. And what they noticed about one particular tribe of monkeys is that there was one female monkey, an older female monkey, so they used to eat sweet potatoes off the ground. And there was an older female monkey that would pick up her sweet potato and would try to clean the dirt off it. And macaque monkeys, if you don't know, are terrified of water. So if you see them in a zoo, they don't need to be encaged in anything. There's just water all around them because they won't cross the boundary. And this particular monkey, who they named Emo, would go down, discovered one day that if she went down to the water and washed her sweet potato, not only did the dirt go away, but the salt made it actually taste better. And so she tried to encourage all the other monkeys to do the same, but they were too afraid. So she started to, as babies were being born, she used to take the babies and she used to take them down to the water and show them to wash their sweet potatoes. And over time, what started to occur is that more and more of the monkeys in that particular, in Emo's tribe, would wash off their sweet potatoes. But what another group of scientists discovered in another part of Japan who are also studying macaque monkeys is that those same type of monkeys, that same species of monkeys, all of a sudden began to wash their sweet potatoes. They'd eliminated the fear from their life. So the moral of the story is when 4% of a population makes a shift, it actually affects all other members of that species. So as you listen to Marianne, and as you spend your weekend here at Bloom, I invite you to be part of that 4% that's making a change and making a shift, knowing that everything that we do here, the space that we create, and as she talks about love, as more of us move into that resonance of love, we create a space where over time, perhaps we'll change the entire species. Namaste.
All right, guys. Now, like all of you, I'm excited to share this space with none other than Marianne Williamson. She is a number one New York Times best-selling author, an internationally acclaimed lecturer, and the founder of Project Angel Food, a Meals on Wheels program that serves homebound people with AIDS in the Los Angeles area. It currently feeds over 1,000 people every single day. Her newest book, A Return to Love, is considered a must-read, and if you have ever heard this quote before, our deepest fear is not that we are inadequate. Our deepest fear is that we are powerful beyond measure, than you have heard her before. Her words are considered an anthem for so many looking for strength and courage, and I'm so honored to introduce her to you this evening. She truly is a global force. Ladies and gentlemen, Marianne Williamson.
Extraordinary opportunity it is to be able to speak into the listening already created by the marvelous presenters, all of the participants here. So thank you for having me. Thank you for giving me this opportunity to enter into discussion with you. Before we do anything else, please join with me. Let's take a deep breath. Closing our eyes. We see in the middle of our mind a little ball of golden light. And now we watch this light as it begins to grow larger and larger, until now it covers the entire inner vision of our mind. And we see for ourselves within this light a beautiful temple. We see a garden that surrounds the temple and a body of water that flows through the garden. We see that the inside of the temple is lit as well by this same beautiful golden light. And here we are. For we have been drawn together by the power and in the presence of all that that is holy. It is to that creative force, that all-powerful, all-creative, and all-loving force, that we dedicate our time spent together and all of our relationships to one another, praying that that spirit might enter into the deepest regions of every thought and every feeling, that we might thus be lifted above and beyond the sorrows, despair, depression, fear, and limitations of this world to the love and to the peace that lay beyond. And so it is, together we all say, Amen. I know many of you, if not all of you, are involved on some level with yoga, and you are already concerned with the issues of the right positioning of the body. Anytime we do exercise of the physical body, we're doing that in order to hone the physical muscles. Whether it's yoga or any other physical exercise, we do it so that we can move. We do it so that we can be strong in body and we can go out into the world and we can do whatever it is we want to do. Spiritual exercise is analogous. But whereas we do physical exercise to hone the physical muscles, we do spiritual exercise to hone the attitudinal muscles. We do it not so that we can go out there and move. We do it so that we can be still. We do it so that we can be non-reactive. And it is that combination of power on the outside as well as power on the inside that makes us the people that we need to be at this time. Now, when I say the people we need to be at this time, we're talking about more than just the people that we want to be. You know, in the physical body, first there's an egg and a sperm, and then this miraculous process begins, doesn't it? Whereas all these cells begin to emerge, and every cell is imbued with this natural intelligence. And every cell emerges, it becomes that which it is to be, and then it collaborates with other cells who have become what they need to be. And out of that collaboration, where they by work together in order to create and to foster the healthy functioning of that which is greater than they, a brain emerges, heart emerges, a liver emerges, fingers emerge, a brain emerges, and so forth. And then even after that embryo becomes a baby and the baby is born onto the earth, those cells continue to function inside you. And those cells continue to function in a way that they collaborate and serve the healthy functioning of the organ and the organism of which they are a part. And your lungs are breathing right now. Your heart is beating right now. But every once in a while, a cell decides for whatever reason, I don't want to. And it disconnects from that natural intelligence. And instead of collaborating with other cells in order to together serve the healthy functioning of the whole, it goes off to do its own thing, to build its own kingdom. I don't want to just live to serve the healthy functioning of the liver. I don't want to just live to serve the healthy functioning of the lungs. I want to go off and do my own thing. What do we call that? It's cancer. It is a malignancy in the body, and it is a malignancy in consciousness. And that is what is wrong with the human race, a malignant consciousness whereby we have forgotten we're here together to collaborate with each other, to serve something bigger than we. We're off into this me consciousness, doing what we want, and with that consciousness, this whole thing is going down. And so we are called upon to heal in order to once again connect, as they say in Alcoholics Anonymous, conscious contact with our natural intelligence, so that once again we collaborate. And at this time, the particular system of the body that we are all called to be part of, in terms of the psychic landscape of the human race, is the immune system. Now, when the cells emerge in the body, they're assigned. Some are assigned to the liver, some are assigned to the spleen, some are assigned to the lungs, some are assigned to the heart. And so you and I are assigned as well. Some people are assigned to the arts, some people are assigned to the sciences, some people are assigned to education, some people are assigned to politics, some people are assigned to business, some people are assigned to Canada, some people are assigned to Argentina, some people are assigned to Asia, some people are assigned to Africa. The point is, what happens when we know that we're not here just to do what I might feel like doing at any given moment, but when we, just like we do with the practice of yoga, know that we want to be in right position. That's what yoga is when we do it physically, and that's what yoga is when we do it attitudinally. May I be in the right position. May my spine be correct. May my muscles be lined up in such a way that I can be the strongest that I can be so that I can self-actualize. And then, just like in the cells of the body, as I self-actualize, I then vibrationally, through a vibrational frequency, more naturally find myself in collaboration with those who are vibrating at that same level of frequency, just as if I'm at a lower level of frequency, cancer cells also attract other cells around them, cells that are as sick as they are. We are living, ladies and gentlemen, in revolutionary times. We are living at a time at which humanity now stands at a crossroads. We will either move now into a trajectory of mass enlightenment, or we will move into a trajectory of mass destruction. Those are our only two options over the next 20 years. And just as when we as individuals have a sense something is wrong, we collectively know that something is wrong. But if you only know that something is wrong, then you are concentrating on, if you look at this in metaphysical terms of the crucifixion and the resurrection, the crucifixion is a metaphysical term which means the energy pattern by which the ego or the malignant consciousness seeks to destroy that which is loving, destroying that which is life-producing. The resurrection is what happens when the mind awakens, and instead of the mind serving the processes of destruction, the mind services the processes of healing and co-creation. Now, if all you do is look at the crucifixion, then you become part of the power of the crucifixion. But if you just skip the crucifixion and go right to the resurrection, you're not in transcendence, you're in denial. And so what the world needs now, the last thing we need is for people among the spiritual and transformational communities to be dwelling in some la-la land where we're saying, well, I just can't look at the darkness of the world. I'm trying to live a positive life. I'm very empathic, and that gets me very, very upset. I cannot let all that negativity in. Those of us into higher consciousness, those of us into personal growth, those of us into spirituality, those of us into recovery should be the biggest grown-ups in society, not the little children too ditzy to do anything about the problems. And the reason we should be the biggest grown-ups is because if you know what heals one heart, you're the one who knows what heals the world. So you can't just skip the crucifixion. That's not transcendence, that's denial. We want to be practitioners of positive denial. Positive denial is not where you look away from the problems of the world. You look right at the problems of the world and you deny their power over you. You deny their power over this planet. Because you see, there are a lot of forces that represent the collective ego of humanity. Not just one person's desire, it's like alcoholism. Alcoholism is not just seeking to destroy the alcoholic. The alcoholism is seeking to destroy their entire family. The alcoholism is seeking to destroy everybody unfortunate enough to get involved with them. And so it is with any form of collective ego or collective fear. It is, you know, the Course in Miracles has a line where it says, the ego is suspicious at best and vicious at worst. And so, you know, alcoholism, addiction, and so forth, they're not just out to inconvenience you, they are out to kill you. And so these collective forms of ego, whether it has to do with complete irresponsibility towards the physical environment, whether it has to do with complete violence and irresponsibility with our military misadventures and whatever other way we choose to show complete irreverence towards life itself on this planet, those forces and those trajectories are not just out to inconvenience us. They are out to kill us. And I know that we all know, all of us in here know, that there is a way in which whatever the public problems are, they will get to your private door in time. There's just so much green juice you can drink. If they're poisoning the food supply, your food will be poisoned as well. So whether it's GMOs or anything else, we must awaken. And those of us who are practitioners of the spiritual arts, we should be the people who are most prepared to be the space of possibility. And we are the space of possibility by being what the Course in Miracles calls the presence of the alternative. The presence of the alternative, meaning the immune cell in the psychic landscape of humanity at this time, means that we have what it takes because we have built the biological musculature through such things as yoga, but also the emotional musculature, the spiritual musculature, the psychological musculature, to be able to endure what is happening when one entire epic of history is falling down around us. One epic of history is falling down around us because its tenets in its foundational principles are no longer sustainable. We have now evolved as Western civilization to a place where short-term economic gain for huge multinational forces is now the bottom line for our international functioning more than humanitarian principles by which concern and care for the human race comes first. That is unsustainable. It is not aligned with the truth of nature, and therefore one world is crumbling. There is not a question whether or not one world is crumbling and another will now rise. The only question is how much human suffering has to accompany the transition. And that is why each of us are called to be the presence of the alternative, to be someone who ourselves are not at the effect of the chaos. That's what the internal yoga is all about, so that we can remain non-reactive, so that we can remain not at the effect of the chaos of the times in which we live, but people in whose presence, number one, other people suffer less because they sense they are in the presence of someone whose compassion and love is so great that even this can be endured. But also because we stand with the intention, not just to get what we want. Talk about faux spirituality. Seems these days, every time you go into a meeting, somebody says, okay, what's our intention for this meeting? Sounds kind of spiritual, doesn't it? Can we talk for a minute about why that's not necessarily spiritual at all? If we go into a meeting, somebody says to me, well, what's your intention? Oh, my intention is to sell 50 units of my product. Then what you're doing actually is programming your own subconscious mind to manipulate, to exploit, to do whatever necessary in order to get other people to do what you want. That's not called relationship. That's called transaction. And that's what's wrong with the world today. We have become more transactional than relational. Rather, the issue is to say my intention is that love's intention, use me. Another way of saying this is, may God's will be done. God being love, will meaning thought. So if you're looking at concepts like God's will from a metaphysical perspective, you're not going into any meeting, whether it's a date, whether it's your lover, whether it's your spouse, whether it's your child, whether it's your business meeting, whether it's an audition, no matter what it is, what you are inside doing is saying, may love use me. May God's will be done, because even though this looks like a business meeting, really, it's God meeting God. Even though it looks like a business meeting or any other human interaction, what it really is the cells seeking other cells with which to collaborate in order to rise to a collective service to that which is most healed and whole. And so, by the way, you don't mention this to anybody because a lot of people don't understand. Well, it's nothing you like say, it's something you're thinking. So just keep it to yourself, just keep it between us, just in this room. So you're going into any place you're going, you could be going into a party, you're going into a business meeting, you're going wherever you are, and you're blasting that place with love before you even go. That's your intention. That's why in the Course in Miracles we're taught every morning, where would you have me go? What would you have me do? What would you have me say and to whom? And that's it. It's that we ask only to be empty. That's like in the Eastern religions, you know. They talk about becoming, in Zen Buddhism, the Zen mind is the beginner's mind, the empty mind. Present an empty rice bowl. In the West, the Western parallel to that is the notion in the New Testament of be ye as a little child. The reason the Course in Miracles says you want to be as a little child is because children know they don't know. We think we know. And we're taught, even if you don't know, pretend like you know. And so to be as a little child means to go into any situation and in the deepest level to say, I have no idea why I'm here. I mean, I know the material reasons why I'm here. But I can't possibly know how what I say or what I do might affect any individual sentient being, past, present, or future, but there is a natural intelligence within me that does know. And that's why enlightenment is not a learning process. Enlightenment is an unlearning. The job of enlightenment, the Course in Miracles tells us, is a shift in self-perception from body identification to spirit identification. If I'm dwelling in body identification, it's all about me. And I'm over here and you're over there. And it's about me and my circumstances and my resume and my successes and my failures and my opinions and other people's opinions of me and my past and my future. May you grow as bored by that entire narrative as the people around you already probably are. Now, if we shift to spirit identification, there's an image that the Course in Miracles uses that says, you are like sunbeams, thinking you're separate from other sunbeams. You are like waves in the ocean, thinking you're separate from other waves. Now, look at the emotional ground that you stand on, depending whether you think of yourself as a separate wave or a wave that's one with the rest of the ocean. If I think of myself as one wave over here, surrounded by the whole ocean, how could I not be terrified of the ocean? How could I not be terrified that in any given moment I might be overwhelmed by that which is so much greater than I? But if instead I realize that there actually is no place where one wave stops and another wave starts, that there actually is no place where one sunbeam stops and another sunbeam starts, then I think of myself as one with the ocean. And instead of being afraid, I'm pretty impressed by who I am. Yeah, I'm part of this whole thing. This whole thing's pretty powerful. I move, it moves. Because that's the way it really happens. We know that when a butterfly flaps its wings down by the South Pole, it affects the wind currents at the North Pole. That's like scientific fact. And so, just as in the realm of three dimensions, I'm over here and you're over there, what books like The Course in Miracles tells us is that the entire three-dimensional plane is one vast mortal hallucination. It's a vast mortal hallucination or illusion. But beyond that is a quantum field of ultimate reality. And in that quantum field of ultimate reality, there is no place where I stop and you start. That's why the Course in Miracles says anytime you're about to have anger or judgment or blame or attack towards another human being, just think of a sword that's falling on their head, but be very clear, it is falling on your own. Einstein said, as do all of those books, that time and space themselves are illusions of consciousness. Now, we were hearing a few minutes ago about this idea of the 100th monkey, this idea of the tipping point. You know, sometimes we get a little too concerned about the majority. We go, well, you know, we're all filled with love, but look at all those people out there who are filled with hate. Look at all those governments that are using huge resources of technology and business and money to do things that we think are actually destructive towards the planet, destructive towards the possibilities for human survival. And it's very tempting to get very depressed because you think of all the people that you know who are so into love and into enlightenment, but you think, yeah, but we're just a sort of tiny portion of the human race. But ladies and gentlemen, don't worry about that. The majority has never affected huge issues of social change. The majority doesn't wake up one morning and say, oh, let's end slavery. The majority doesn't wake up one morning and say, oh, let's give women the right to vote. That's not how it's ever happened in any of our countries. Always, human race changes. Human epics change. Human historical transitions happen because a small group of people, usually considered outrageous radicals by the status quo of their time, have a better idea. That's how society changes. Just like when you and I were little children and we studied evolution. And we were told that when a species gets to a point where its collective behavioral patterns are no longer well adaptive for the survival of that species, then something's going to happen. Either the species goes extinct because its behavior is maladaptive, or a mutation occurs. And then that mutation, even though the mutation does not represent the majority of the species, the descendants of the mutation are the ones who survive and the species moves in that direction. That's where we are as a human race. Our collective behavioral patterns are maladaptive for our survival. We fight too much and we are systematically destroying our own habitat. The mutations have occurred. They are the great religious and spiritual figures throughout history, and they all point to another way of being on the planet. And that is what we are asked to be. We are asked to be the mutational field. We are asked to be that resonant field. We are asked to be that field of consciousness, which, as I said, does not have to be a majority, never has. Earlier it was suggested it's 4%. Some people feel it is pi, which is less than 4%. Some social scientists say it's up to 11%. But the point is, it's nowhere near the majority. That which has to change in order for the entire system to move in another direction. And so even if you look at the numbers, there are far more people on this planet who have love in their hearts than who have hate in their hearts. There are far more people on this earth who just want to live and raise their children and feed their children and live a decent life and leave a better life to their children. Clearly, the vast majority of people on the planet feel that way and even live that way. So what's going on? Why is it that a relatively small group of people on this planet, because only a relatively tiny group of people on this planet, truly hate and truly live for purposes that are actually anti the thriving of life? Why is it that hate and destructiveness seems to be winning when the vast majority of people live from a place of love and co-creation and decency to the best of their ability? I'll tell you how. Those who hate, hate with conviction. Conviction is a force multiplier. The Course in Miracles says miracles arise from conviction. You know, every time there is a terrorist act, I know my president, probably your prime minister, I don't know, usually most leaders of the advanced world, whenever there's a terrorist incident, they all tend to say the same thing, that this cowardly act will not be tolerated. You know what I say? Forget the cowardly act. Hatred has a perverse kind of courage. The problem is not that hate is cowardly. The problem today is that love is cowardly. We don't have more people hating than loving, but we have a smaller group of people who hate with conviction. And when those of us who love, love with conviction, the way those who hate do, those who hate have made it very clear on this planet, and are making it very clear as we speak, they will do whatever it takes to effectuate the kind of changes on the planet that they want. When you and I step it up, when you and I dig deeper down, when you and I show greater conviction, when you and I take it out of the yoga studio and out into the world, when you and I, as people who stand for the possibilities of love, say enough is enough with these 14,000 children who starve every day. Enough is enough with destroying our planet. Enough is enough with all of the ways that hatred would destroy the planet. When we step it up in terms of our conviction, when enough of us love with a kind of conviction that those who hate display, then this world will change in a blinking of an eye, and you and I will all be able to say, yeah, I had something to do with that. None of us are told what other people are supposed to do. The cells of the liver are not given guidance for what the cells in the lung are supposed to do. Each and every one of us have our own guidance system. Each and every one of us has an internal teacher by whatever name we call it. As we pray, as we meditate, you know, the Dalai Lama says, to solve the world's problems, we must have a plan, but no plan will work unless we meditate. Each and every one of us has a direct radio hookup to the divine force that leads all things to divine right action in order to heal that which has been broken on the planet. The problem is not that any of us do not have that voice within us. The problem is that for most of us, there's so much static in the radio that we can't hear it. And that's what happens when you wake up in the morning and you turn on the computer right away, or you turn on the newspaper right away, or read the newspaper right away, or turn on the radio, or turn on television. That's why every great religious and spiritual system that I know anything about talks about the power of prayers in the morning. Because in the morning is when our minds are most open to receive new impressions. You wake up in the morning, you take a shower. You wake up in the morning, you take a bath. Why do you wash? You wash your body because you do not want to take yesterday's dirt with you out into today. But if you wake up in the morning and you don't meditate, if you wake up in the morning and you don't pray, you wake up in the morning and don't do whatever your serious spiritual practice is, then even though your body might be purified of outer contaminants, your mind is not purified of the stress of your life. And even when you wash your body, it's just your dirt, maybe another person's. I don't know how you roll, maybe one other person in addition, I don't know. But if you don't purify your thinking through meditation and prayer, then you're not just taking your own stress. You're taking the stress of everybody in the Sudan. You're taking your stress of everybody in Syria. You're taking your stress of everybody in Afghanistan. And then you wonder why you're depressed by noon. Now, I'm not saying if we meditate in the morning that we will be enlightened masters by the end of the day. That's not what I'm saying. But I am saying this. If we meditate in the morning, the chances of our doing something really, really stupid today is drastically reduced. The Course in Miracles says 5 minutes with God's Spirit in the morning is enough to guarantee He will be in charge of your thought forms throughout the day. That means you're probably not going to send that text. You might want to, you might write it, but you'll delete it before sending it. You know, that text that otherwise would make you sorry that you send it for the next 6 months. You're less likely to make that phone call. You're less likely to send that email. You're less likely to sabotage on some huge level. And the point is, ladies and gentlemen, that that force which would have you self-sabotage, that force that would have you send the stupid email in order to ruin the relationship, the force that would have you say the stupid thing that would ruin your job is the same force with which humanity is setting out on a suicide mission as we speak. You know, years ago I told myself, don't worry about the devil. That's ridiculous. There is nothing out there stalking the planet for our souls. It's ridiculous. It's all in your mind. And then I thought about this for a moment, and I realized that's the worst place it could possibly be. To say that there's something inside the mind is not like good news. Because the idea that there's not something out there, okay, we've all evolved beyond that. But that doesn't mean that there's not something in here. And that something that is in here, by whatever name we call it, is a force of consciousness which dwells within all of us until we are enlightened masters, which would always be tempting us to perceive without love. And the mind is so powerful that according to A Course in Miracles and other metaphysical teachings, every thought creates form on some level. So with every thought, we are either opening ourselves to love, thereby putting us in alignment with the natural intelligence that will lead us instant by instant to collaborate with those who are similarly vibrating in order to serve the healthy functioning of the whole, and in this case, to restore and to heal the whole, or we are closed to love, in which case we are deflecting the miracles that would otherwise occur. Back in the 60s, they used to say, if you're not part of the solution, you're part of the problem. And that's what's happening today. You can mismanage your mind, but we cannot, we're told, diminish the power of our mind. So these are very urgent times. We can see all around us that the power of fear is intensifying. We can see the sunset effect of the old order. But we can also see that the forces of love are intensifying as well. The only thing I think for those of us in the transformational and higher consciousness community have to be aware of is that sometimes our shadow is a denial of the shadow. And as we deny the shadow in ourselves, then we are then denying, no longer placing ourselves in a position where we can be true transformers of the shadow of the entire world. And in revolutionary times, to sit it out is to deny your function. I believe that we should honor our incarnation. If whatever your color, whatever your ethnicity, whatever your nationality, whatever your sex, whatever your sexuality, we incarnated within that container, and we are stewards of the progress of the karma, of the movement forward through time, of that particular vector of reality. And part of honoring our incarnation is knowing that we either chose or were chosen, however all that works, to be right here, right now. And for those of us who are here as citizens of an advanced democracy, you know, I remember when the Dalai Lama said that if the world is saved, it will be in large part because of the Western woman. Now, on one hand, great. And I certainly have the same honor and the same respect and the same admiration for the Dalai Lama as anybody does, but we do not need a man to verify this. In every advanced mammalian species that survives and thrives, there is a common anthropological characteristic, and that is the fierce behavior of the adult female of the species when she senses there is a threat to her cubs. You see this with the mama bear, you see it with the mama tiger, you see it with the mama lion. They are fierce when they think that there is something or someone who in any way threatens the survival of their cubs. And when they show that fierceness, we do not say about them, oh, no, I think she's strident. We do not say about them, oh, I think she has some anger issues. And yet, ladies and gentlemen, if you see the collective behavioral patterns of the women on this planet, given the threats that are being faced daily by too many of the young on this planet, we as the adult females of our species are not currently displaying the behavior that bespeaks a species intending to survive. Not only that, but those of us who are women, who are citizens of the countries with the kind of extraordinary powers and the extraordinary rights and opportunities that we have in living in countries like yours and mine, I think that we should think of ourselves not only as speaking for ourselves, but also speaking for the millions of women around the world who, should they speak a fraction of what we are able to speak, would be lashed, if not killed, for doing so. And so we have to use our voices as never before. And living a meaningful life is not a popularity contest. And so it's very, very fun to be in places like you're at this weekend. It's very wonderful to be surrounded by people who think the way we think. But where the rubber meets the road is not just what happens here. Where the rubber meets the road is what happens when we all leave here. Because when we're talking about these ideas that this entire weekend is about, it's easy enough to recognize that these ideas are common sense. But the reason we are here, the reason that these events are so important, is because, as the Course in Miracles says, ideas grow stronger when they're shared. We're here for a kind of battery charge. You're not living, we're not, this is 2015. You're not coming to an event like this to hear something you don't already know. That was 10 years ago, that was 20 years ago. 10 or 20 years ago, you came to hear someone like myself and you go, wow, that's really interesting, I never thought of it that way. That's not the time we're living in. Today, it's more like you hear someone like myself and go, isn't that interesting, that's exactly what we were saying last night. You don't come here to hear something you don't already know. We've all read the same books now. We've all listened to the same tapes now. We are here at a weekend like this to deepen our access to the understanding of the ideas which by now we all already know, so that when we leave here, we can kick ass. And every cell has its assignment, and each one of us has our assignment. If you were to say to me, what am I supposed to do? I don't know what you're supposed to do. The voice for God within you will tell you what you're supposed to do. But there are certain principles, and those principles of attitude, those correct positions of attitude, are very similar to asanas in yoga. They're very similar to the correct positioning in yoga. So let's just go through what they are. Number one. Time itself is an illusion. It's part of the illusion. Reality, with a capital R, ultimate reality, is in that quantum field beyond time and space. Time itself is an illusion of consciousness. The past exists only in your mind. The future exists only in your mind. In the Course in Miracles, Spirit says, give me your past so I can change your mind about it for you. Only love is real Everything else is an illusion. So in any moment when you're thinking about the past, you're out of position, you're out of right alignment. Any moment you're focused on the future, you're out of position, you're out of right alignment. In the present, in the holy instant, the universe is already programmed to heal whatever needs to be healed from the past and to reprogram in a correct way the future. The way to take care of the future is to live fully in the present. And what the ego mind, the malignant consciousness wants is for us to always be obsessed about the past or always be obsessed about the future. Why? So that we miss the moment of power, so that we miss the moment of the present, so that we miss the miracle. That's one attitude, one asana of power. The other is forgiveness. Only love is real. Nothing else exists. All the love that anyone ever gave you was real. All the love you ever gave anyone was real. The rest was a hallucination. Either their hallucination or your hallucination or a hallucination you had together. And in any given moment, forgiveness, it doesn't mean you're a jerk, but I'm spiritual, so I forgive you. That is not evolved, enlightened understanding of forgiveness. Forgiveness is rather when, as I said before, you stand as the presence of the alternative. No matter what anyone says, no matter what anyone does, you know, even if they are not giving me love, if they are not giving me love, or if they haven't given me love, it's only because they have fallen asleep to who they are. They disconnected in that moment from the truth of their being. Their truth of their being is love. They were wounded, probably in childhood, just like me. They didn't wake up this morning and say, I think I'll be a jerk, any more than I woke up on the morning when I acted like a jerk and said, oh, I think I'll be a jerk. Therefore, in this moment, I can, one of two things, either fall into their spiritual sleep with them, in which case I attach my belief to their lovelessness and then react to their lovelessness and then become part of that cycle of violence, or I can remain awake even though they have fallen asleep. And if I remain awake to the love, knowing that if it's not love they've shown me, I can interpret it as a call for love. If I can choose to focus on what they've done right, even if, even in this moment, they are not showing me all their goodness, then I become an awakener. By my choosing to remain awake, I awaken them. Now, some people would say to you, well, that's being a bit of a Pollyanna, isn't it? Can we talk about Pollyanna for a moment? Pollyanna is an image of power. She goes into a situation where everybody's in a bad mood. By the time the story's over, everybody's happy. Hello, she is a transformational figure. So if anybody says to you, you're just being a Pollyanna, you should say to them, thank you, I try, I practice, I meditate, I really work on that. May you and I be so transformational as Pollyanna is, to go into a situation where at the end of it, that really mean old lady got married. Wear it proudly. It's like, if you take yourself this seriously, to know that you really are here, not just to get what you want or to do what you want, but to be part of this great underground, by which spirit is using those of us who choose to be so used as the immune cells in the body of humanity to see yourself that powerfully. The Course in Miracles says, who are these cells? Who are these teachers, i.e. demonstrators of God, i.e. love? The Course in Miracles says it's anyone who chooses to be one. They come from all religions and no religions. And when you hold yourself from this place internally, there are people around you who just might say, who do you think you are? God's gift to the world, to which you should respond in whatever way appropriate. Yeah. As are you and you and you. The Course in Miracles says none of us are special, but all of us are special. Another principle for us to remember, that correct positioning, all of us are special, but none of us are special. Each and every one of us is imbued with an unlimited potential to be used in the service of the healing of the world. And to the extent to which we wake up every morning And we don't concern ourselves with the nonsense. We don't allow ourselves to be at the effect of the barrage of modernity, the 24-hour news cycle, the 24-hour, the assaults on the internet and everything else. But rather, we wake up in the morning and we choose to be clothed in spirit. And we do yoga, we do that which is our physical processing, we do that which is our nutritional processing, in order that this body, the body that is nothing really more than a suit of clothes, a priceless and precious suit of clothes, might serve us in our time on this earth. The Course in Miracles says, physical birth is not a beginning, but a continuation, and physical death is not the end, but a continuation. That which is what we truly are is one with everyone, and that which is what we truly are is one for all time. As I said before, somewhat glibly, but it's actually very serious, do not mention this to people who would not understand, because they can diminish your faith that this is so. But when you are in places like this, and you are having these conversations, then we are taking part in a great and glorious building up of that 100th monkey phenomenon, building up of that resonant field whereby humanity is going to interrupt the current trajectory of human history. One of the reasons we all relate so much to the story of the Titanic is not just because it was a good movie, but because archetypally we all know we're on it. This planet, the entire human race is on the Titanic and we're headed for the iceberg. The iceberg could be nuclear, the iceberg could be biochemical, the iceberg could be climate change, it could make many different forms. The issue for us now is not what form the iceberg would take. The issue for us is that we need to turn this ship around. And the impulse for doing so is happening. It is not centered in any one ethnicity, any one culture, any one religion or lack thereof. It is not centered in any one part of the world. It is something coming up from the bottom of things. It has led you and me to be here this weekend. It has led other people to be in other groups and other places wherever they are all over the world. And it is all part of this rising spirit of love. It is as though it's a race for time. We have everything we need. All the geniuses all around the world who know what the solutions are, who are already demonstrating the best practices. We have everything in alignment. You and I, most of us, if you're even at a point in your life where you are even here this weekend, means you're already responding to the call. As I see it, as I travel all around the world, I don't feel that this is a time when we need to wake people up. Enough of us are awakened now. The issue is that those of us who are somewhat awakened need to become more intentional around being used as conduits, more intentional about seeing the purpose of our lives as forgiving, being more intentional about being the purpose of our lives, being that we give love and that we receive love. That we spend as much time as necessary cleaning up our own personal relationships, taking care of our own personal shadows, as well as showing up for ways that we can contribute to the healing of the wounds of our countries and our continents and our world. You know, I was once at Yosemite Park in California, in Northern California. I don't know how it is in Canada, but in the United States, only 2% of the redwood trees that used to be there are now even left. And those that are left are there for us to enjoy, primarily because of one man who over 100 years ago recognized the sacred quality of this part of nature, did everything he could to buy up land of these redwoods and then bequeath them to his own descendants and make in perpetuity laws that these redwoods could never be cut down. And when you walk through these redwoods and this magnificence of these gigantic trees that are hundreds of years old, I always feel like my soul just tingles. And I always think about that one man. He was an army general. That one man. And it is because of him that we have those redwood trees. And there are things here in Canada, there are things in every country that the citizens of that country get to enjoy because of people who aren't even alive anymore, but did what they did, and in some cases sacrificed what they sacrificed so that we could experience what we experience. And it seems to me that when we do experience those things, wherever they are, their souls must tingle. So, ladies and gentlemen, if you and I begin to take more seriously the intentionality of the universe, knowing that the universe, just as the natural intelligence leads the embryo to become a baby, and the natural intelligence leads the acorn to become the oak tree, and that natural intelligence that leads the bud to become a blossom, that same natural intelligence also intends that you and I become enlightened, that you and I become the highest possibility of human manifestation that we can be in this lifetime, and that possibility is unlimited. And the universe is going to put us through everything necessary. Sometimes it'll be fun, sometimes it won't be fun because we're resisting the change. We are going through everything necessary in order to become the people we are capable of being. And that's all that's happening in any given day. That's all that's happening in any given situation. That's all that's happening in any given circumstance. You and I are being called. How are you going to play it? You're going to play it from weakness? Because that's how you played it last time. Or you could choose to play it from strong this time. You were pretty good last time. You want to be great this time? You weren't that good last time. You want to be good this time? Yeah, you're wounded in this area, but why don't you choose not to act from your wound? And if we're serious about it and we're really looking clearly, we see that that's all that any situation is. That's all that any circumstance is. That's all that any conversation is. And if we leave this place this weekend, having been given these tools, these extraordinary tools that you're being given by every booth and every presenter and every participant, then we will leave from this place and we will become ever more. Some days we'll fall, some hours, some days, some situations we fall off the spiritual wagon, but we get back on, and more we will become the people we are capable of being. And we will not be women acting like little girls. We will not be men acting like little boys. We will become who we are capable of being. And then, as we do that, as we give ourselves over to this process of healing, to this process of the immune system, I'm not saying necessarily that before each of us dies that we will have seen a planet in which there is no longer any unnecessary human suffering. I'm not saying that in our lifetime we will see the complete eradication of war. I'm not saying that in our lifetime we will see the complete eradication of all the various forms of horror by which humanity inflicts insane amount of violence on other humans. I'm not saying that, but I am saying this. If we do what we can, and we become who we can become, and we allow ourselves to be more and more open to the possibilities that nature intends for us, then wherever we are on that day, wherever we are, just like those people from our various countries who no longer live on this planet, but when you and I appreciate and enjoy what they did for us, their souls tingle wherever they are. If you and I become who we're capable of being, then when those days come, that there is no more war, and there is no more unnecessary suffering on this planet, then wherever we are, our souls will tingle, and we know we had something to do with it. We did good. Thank you very, very much. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you, Edmonton. Thank you so much. Thank you. Thank you. Now, do we take some questions and do that? Okay. Well, I suppose there's someone out there with microphones. Is that right? There are microphones there, and there are microphones on both sides. And whatever topic you bring up or a question you bring up, I will do my best to reflect on that from the perspective of the principles of A Course in Miracles, which is just one statement of universal spiritual truth. There is one truth with a capital T, of course, and it's spoken in many different ways, none any better or worse than any other. Okay, let's do that. Yes, sir.
Hi.
Hi.
Thank you for everything and what you've shared. It's really
you.
Lovely. And I would really like to thank as well for eye gazing with you earlier. That was
yes,
really
we
lovely.
Did.
I figured that'd be something unique. My question is more on an individual sense in
okay.
love,
okay.
particularly with how to navigate in a relationship where there's a wanting and a desire to live an individual life.
Okay.
And participating in the relationship.
Okay.
And what that means, say for myself to be able to accept that and be able to live my own life and for my partner to live her own life and then coming together through that bond.
Okay. When I was talking a few minutes ago about how the universe is intentional, the Course in Miracles says that relationships are assignments. They are assignments made by Spirit, by whatever name we call Holy Spirit, which represent the maximal soul growth opportunity for both individuals. When you bring together rough diamonds, rough amethysts, rough sapphires, rough emeralds, how are they made smooth? They are made smooth by being rubbed up against each other. So your rough edges are gonna rub up against my rough edges. That's called relationship. Many times when we are in relationship going, this is terrible, somebody up there is going, oh, this is good. Because what we've all heard that line, love brings up everything unlike itself. The Course in Miracles says you cannot bring the light to the darkness, you must bring the darkness to the light. Cause and effect is the basic building block of the universe. In the East, it's called karma. So if things aren't working in your life, including relationships, you can't ask Spirit to change the effect because God himself will not violate the law he set up. But what you can do is ask Spirit to enter into your thinking. Spirit will not reorder your thoughts without your requesting it, because that would be a violation of your free will. That which we put on the altar is then altered. The altar is in the mind. So if you put a relationship on the altar, that is to say, may I think about this person the way that would lead to behavior that blesses them. That is what we do with relationships. To surrender anything to God, to anything to the divine, is to surrender it to the forces which would uplift our thinking. Now, to be in right relationship, in just like we were talking about the body and the attitudes, right relationship in relationship is one in which there is healthy independence and healthy interdependence or relationship. Just like the cells in the body that collaborate, when they collaborate, they do not become each other. They still dwell and exist as healthy independent cells. Now, we all know, enough of us have been around this community of thought, we know that often those who are codependent, those who lean a little too much and are too dependent, you know, the Course in Miracles says you think you have many different problems, but you really only have one, and that is your separation from God. If you don't lean on God, you know, Bob Dylan has a song, you're gonna have to serve somebody. It might be the devil and it might be the Lord, but you're gonna have to serve somebody. Some people say, I don't like the idea of leaning on God. Fine. I just know that if you don't lean on God, see, the soul leans, then you are more likely to find yourself leaning on something or someone you had best not lean on. So those who lean too much on other people, who idolize other people, as we know, are likely to attract avoidance, whose wound is too much. It's independence, it's not actually independence so much as it is fear of relationship. Both are incorrect, but as we make the Spirit, God by whatever name we call it, our primary relationship, that is how we heal all relationship wounds. You don't make the other person your idol. You don't see the other person as the source of your happiness. You don't see the relationship with another person as the source of your happiness. You see Spirit, which is within you, as the source of your happiness. Then it's like a chiropractic adjustment of the soul. This makes you a person who then naturally dwells in an independent state and yet capable of appropriate and foundational merging with another person. Most importantly, then, you are more likely, as in everything we were saying tonight, to attract other people who are vibrating at that same place. So that is why, from a spiritual perspective, we don't try, you know, the Western psychotherapeutic tradition basically analyzes our problems. And that's like analyzing the darkness to get to the light. But you don't hit darkness with a baseball bat. Darkness isn't a thing, it's the absence of a thing. You turn on the light, the darkness is gone. Love's relationship to fear is the same as light's relationship to darkness. You turn on the light, the darkness is gone. So books like A Course in Miracles are very Eastern in feel. You don't analyze the darkness, which is how do I get more independent and codependent and all that stuff. Sometimes, by the way, that can be very helpful analysis. I'm not saying it can't, but the ultimate answer does not lie there. The ultimate answer is more that Eastern, which is you go for God and all that is not authentically you begins to drop. The codependent you is not the authentic you. The avoidant you is not the authentic you. The needy you is not the authentic you. The controlling you is not the authentic you. The selfish you is not the authentic you. The more we worship that which is divine, we are surrendering into that place in which we are renewed and restored and re-emerge as who we authentically are. In which case, questions like that aren't even an issue because neither the other person nor I even have that stuff going on any longer.
Thank you, Marianne. That's a really helpful.
Hi, Marianne. Thank you for your wonderful speech.
Thank you.
My question concerns the idea of death, and I have a big fear of death, and it's because, I mean, it seems like how can I become comfortable with the idea of having to leave this familiar world in which I've become connected to so many people and so many comforts, mm-hmm. and then having to leave it and knowing that it's coming, the end. I mean, it might be like somebody could tell me, well, you'll go to heaven, it's like waking up on the California coast and you'll be in a mansion, everything will be amazing. But I would say to them, can I take my village with me? Can I bring everything I love and care for? And obviously the answer is I cannot. So how do I become comfortable with the change, even if it's a beautiful change, but it's still traumatizing?
Okay. You know, I think it was Werner Erhard who once said, the truth shall set you free, but not immediately. First, it will piss you off. So, I feel about death what most people I know feel. I'm not afraid of death. I am afraid of dying, but I'm not afraid of death. I think a lot of us feel that way. It's what did Woody Allen say? I don't have a problem with death. I just don't want to be there when it happens. So let's talk about the spiritual principle involved. As I said earlier, the Course in Miracles says a physical birth is not the beginning of life, but a continuation. Physical death is not the end of life, but a continuation. The Course in Miracles says the body is merely a suit of clothes. In the enlightened state, we will have evolved to the point where hearing that someone died will not bring up sorrow for anyone involved, because we will actually evolve to the point where we will see the great rays of light around each other. And so the physical body, which is simply a shadow, when we hear that someone has died, it will simply be the removal of the shadow. The Course in Miracles says that one day we will realize death is not the punishment, death is the reward. And I remind you that even hundreds of years ago, before we peripheralized death the way we do now, 2 days ago I was speaking with some hospice volunteers in Kelowna, and this subject, we were talking about this topic of how Western medicine, we've so peripheralized death that we have lost the emotional musculature with which to deal with it. The Jews and the Catholics both have a lot of support, traditional support that is actually very psychologically astute. Protestants just sort of stand around half the time, just really don't know what to do. This is one time where the Catholic and the Jewish religions really do come to the aid of people who don't even think they relate to the religion, but when someone dies, find great succor and comfort in actually following the dictates of that religion. The resurrection, when Jesus said, death will be the last enemy, What he meant from an esoteric perspective is it is the last thing that you will think of as an enemy. And the resurrection means the opening of the inner eye. Resurrection means the opening of the inner eye that we might see that the person who died didn't really die. One of the principles in the Course in Miracles is that death does not exist. What God created is created for all time. The Course in Miracles says we are ideas in the mind of God. Remember, the physical body is just part of the vast hallucination. Now, it's interesting that you say you would be sad to leave behind the people that you love. Well, I don't know how old you are, but I'm old enough that there are also quite a few people I deeply love who are already on the other side. So as sad as I am to leave some people, I'm actually excited about seeing a few others. when I think my parents have both died, my sister has died, it's just my brother and me left. But it's interesting because when I think of our immediate family, the five of us, I don't think, just in my mind, the image I see is not just my brother and me. I see the five of us, but I see like a photograph where my father and my mother and my sister are in photographic negative. I don't know if those of you who are too young even remember when they were photographed. Long ago and far, far away in time. So, the book of life never ends from a spiritual perspective. Chapters end. So when someone you love has died, you are now in a chapter where you are incarnate and they're not. But even if you live to be very, very old, you're going to see them in about a minute and a half because time doesn't even exist. So these are the kinds of thoughts, principles, you know, and the more we know principle, the more it uplifts. The Course in Miracles says it is never a situation that causes you pain. It is your thoughts about the situation that causes you pain. And so as our thoughts about death are healed, I'm not saying that we will become enlightened masters who have no sadness when someone dies, but you can have a sadness that is a peaceful sadness as opposed to a tortured sadness. Now, while we're on that topic, I'd like to mention something related. Deep grief is not a mental illness. And I heard from the people at the hospice meeting that I was at the other day that here in Canada, they have now named deep grief, deep bereavement, as something which is clinically categorized as depression. I don't know if this is happening in Canada, but it's worth mentioning in case it is. In the United States, very clearly, we have a pharmaceutical psychotherapeutic industrial complex. And there are billions of dollars being made. And just as there are gun manufacturers in the United States who seem that they won't be happy until every man, woman, and child has a gun, there are those who seem to not be happy until every man, woman, and child has an antidepressant. I don't know if here in Canada you have a problem with an epidemic of casual antidepressant use, but just in case you are, it's worth mentioning. Grief is part of the immune system of the psyche. When you go to a grief support group, it's grief support, it's not grief denial. And we need to return to a time in our societies where grief is honored. If someone, you hear people these days who lose a family member, and then one woman I met the other night whose husband of something like 50 years died 4 months ago. And someone said to her, "You've got to let this go." No, she doesn't. And it's very important that we remember, particularly in that first year, that the most natural thing to do when something very sad has occurred, including the death of a loved one, that we cry the tears that there are. If you have 35 tears to cry, crying 17 is not enough. And part of going back into the natural rhythms that are healthy and whole and that restore us to the place of abundance and truth and happiness and peace in our lives is honoring all of the human experiences, including grief. But when it comes to death, it can be a grief which, although very, very deep, can still be filled with the peace of knowing they're still there. It's just that they're broadcasting on a channel that my mortal mind doesn't pick up. The more I meditate, the more I pray, the more I see that golden cord that God has tied between me and that person, The more I realize that whom God hath brought together, nothing and no one can put asunder, not even death, the more I'm placed in that very peaceful place where I can wait patiently until that day that we meet again. Anybody else? As far as keeping the body forever, Matt, I want to. There's a line in the Course in Miracles that says, "Why would you want to keep it? Why would you want to?" Yes.
Yes. You made reference to the numerous challenges and pathologies that our species has evolved, and you also made reference to the natural order and intelligence of this of the universe.
Yes.
So I'm wondering what your thoughts would be in terms of what are the source waters and like the why of evolving this way?
The why of?
Like our species evolving with these pathologies and these challenges that you talked about.
You know, in the Course in Miracles it says, in the Bible it says that Adam fell asleep, and nowhere does it say that he woke up. The Course in Miracles says that millions of years ago, in time as we know it, although in reality it never happened at all. Because remember, love is the only thing that is real. That is the mind of God. Love is all that exists. And what is all-encompassing can have no opposite. So millions of years ago, in time as we know it, the Course in Miracles says, we began to think a thought that was without love. Now, a thought that is without love, because only love is real, didn't actually exist. When you're thinking without love, you're actually not thinking, you're hallucinating. In that moment, which interestingly enough, totally aligns with the theory of the Big Bang, the Course in Miracles says it was an instant. The mind is so powerful that the moment there was one loveless thought, the entire mortal world as we know it was born. Now, that does not mean, from the Course in Miracles perspective, that the material world is bad. It's that the material world is nothing. Things in the material world are holy or unholy, the Course says, according to the purpose given to it by the mind. If we see our purpose on this earth to love, including the use of the body, the Course in Miracles says the body is a beautiful lesson in communion until communion is. So when you ask why did it happen, number one, it didn't really happen. Number two, you cannot rationally explain an irrational moment. Number three, there is no time. So if you can tell me, I'd like you to think for a moment, is there anyone in your life you're not totally forgiving? Yes. There is. Can you really tell me why you're not? That, if you could answer that question, you could answer your question. Because there is no time. You are just enacting and over and enacting again and reenacting again the original separation. And the Course says, do not let questions of theology delay you. Go directly for the experience. So why you did it is no different than why you're not forgiving those people. The moment you forgive those people, you are healing the separation. One way of looking at it anyway. Okay, over here. Yes, ma'am.
I'm just wondering, can you please explain the atonement to me a little bit?
The atonement. Mm-hmm. You know, the Catholics have confession as you go along. The Jews have the holiest day of the year is Yom Kippur, or the Day of Atonement. And Alcoholics Anonymous is a program of amends, an atonement, recognizing your character defects, admitting them to another person, doing what you can to restore. So the issue of the atonement is the issue of taking responsibility. Because of cause and effect, if I got it wrong, let's say I was unkind to someone, the law of cause and effect, every action has a reaction. I was unkind. As I said before, that means that the the sword did not just drop on that person, it dropped on me. The Course says an idea does not leave its source. So even if they forgave me because they are enlightened, I will still feel guilty about it, and I will then subconsciously attract punishment. So until I own that I did that, I will continue to create karma around it. The atonement is the correction of perception, where I go back and I get, oh, I get that I said the wrong thing. I wish I hadn't done that. I should have been more merciful. I should have been more compassionate. I was clearly triggered in that moment. She sounded like my mother. But I get that I did that. And I give it over to the Spirit now. And because there's no time, I can choose again in this moment. And I do not have to feel guilty, for Spirit will undo all the consequences of my wrong decision. Because I own what I did, I allow my perception to be corrected. Once again, as I said before, you can't ask God to violate the law of cause and effect. It was set up for our protection. So if I have some area where I got it wrong, for whatever reason, and you can't blame your parents, it doesn't matter where you got it, it's yours now. We have to own, we have to look at that shadow. Once again, you can't bring the light to the darkness, you have to bring the darkness to the light. And when you ask God to heal your life, the way it works is that a magnifying glass is put on issues. And so, you know, it's like somebody said to me at one of my lectures years ago, oh, this all sounds too easy. You're just saying, if you just say, God, take away my anger, you'll never be angry again. I said, that's not what I'm saying at all. I'm saying, if you're saying, God, take away my anger, then everything that could possibly piss you off will be here by late this afternoon. And that will be the universe showing you, this is where you react inappropriately. You want to choose again, because if you ask God's help. So the atonement is the correction of our perception. Now it also exists on another level, which is as I become more corrected, I will then meet people who are more corrected. Now the way relationships work, the Course in Miracles tells us, and for those of you who don't know, the Course in Miracles is not a religion. It is a self-study program of spiritual psychotherapy. It is no better or worse than any other path. It doesn't claim to be for everyone. If it's for you, you know it. It is based on universal, it is a psychological training based on universal spiritual themes. And it is a psychological training in dismantling a thought system based on fear and accepting instead a thought system based on love. When the gentleman was asking before about how all this happened, and I mentioned that the Course says Adam fell asleep and nowhere does it say that he woke up. The Course says ever since that moment, the human race has been dominated by a thought system based on fear, which is that malignant consciousness we were talking about earlier. The Course says there has been no mass awakening, but this is the time to initiate the mass awakening, which is everything we're talking about here. So the atonement both has to do with our going through everything we're going through in order to see where we're off, in order that we heal. But the second level of the atonement is how we are then led to other people in relationship with whom more maximal growth can be achieved for both people. Now, the way relationships work is not that I'm ahead of you or you're ahead of me. The way relationships work, and you can see this in your life much more often, is that let's say you and I are friends. You're half a step ahead in one area. I'm a half a step ahead in another area because we had different childhood, right? So you'll find that's what makes relationships rich, is that you might be able to help me and have more wisdom because you're not as triggered in this area. In another one, I'm more healed. And that's what the atonement is. It's this chain, and that is a chain of correction in our individual lives, but it's also a chain of relationship in our relationships with other people. Does that make sense? Okay. Yes.
Your book, A Return to Love, was transformative for so many, many readers.
Thank you.
I looked at it recently, and again, I was struck with the timeless quality of it. But I also wondered, do you look at it today and think that you could add new experiences, new concerns, new priorities to another version of that book?
Well, the Course, my book, A Return to Love, is like the cliff notes of the Course in Miracles. I don't even know if they still have cliff notes, but it's a simplification, as it were, of the principles of A Course in Miracles. And the reason the quality is timeless is because the universal principle is timeless. I do look at things in that book, and the one that really gets to me is that I'm talking about forgiveness in that book. And I say in that book, oh, you think forgiveness is hard for you. Let me tell you what I've been through. And I give as the example of how hard it can be to forgive that this man like stood me up for a date. That would be somewhat different today. But what I think is so interesting is that I don't remember anybody else thinking either. You know, so the world, obviously in my own experience, I've had some things, but there was a part of a little bit of naivete in that sense was part of what was perfect for that book, too. I get that. So it is what it is, and I'm grateful for it. Thank you. Yes.
Hi, Marianne. My name's Lori, and I'm a recovering perfectionist.
You're a recovering perfectionist. That's fine, because God's perfect, so you don't need to be.
Exactly. My question is related to the Pollyannism.
The Pollyanna image, yes.
That's right. So recently, I feel like I've just woken up after probably 10 years of just being asleep and just kind of walking through a fog.
Right.
And it has something to do with medical stuff. It has something to do with deaths and things in my life.
Yes.
And at that point, someone said to me, geez, you've experienced a lot of loss in your life. And unknowingly, I took that on. And so just about a week ago, walking in a forest, it came to me from the universe that I've experienced a lot of life in my loss. I feel that truly, that is a message that was sent to me. And being here tonight is one of those things that I've opened, and I'm able to be here with you and everyone else. Mm-hmm. However, now I want to run around and tell everyone in my family and everyone I see that I've had this message, and it feels like it wants to bubble out of me, but I don't want to run around imposing or being over Pollyanna. So how do you balance it?
First of all, I don't remember reading that Pollyanna did that.
Okay.
She didn't. It's who she was. The story of Pollyanna is not about her going around saying anything. It's about who she was. Your running around telling everybody what you're just saying would most probably be a form of self-sabotage. If you were doing exactly like you described, it would probably do more to create distance between you and another person than not. As far as the fact that you've been through a period and suffered great loss and somebody has pointed that out to you, it probably is true. And I think there are times in life where we do need to honor that we have experienced great loss. But it's also helpful to remember that so has everyone else. It's helpful to remember that if everybody in this room thinks of the moment or the moments when you have suffered the most, and I'd like you to take just a moment and think of the moment or moments in your life when you have suffered the most. Okay, have you gotten that? Now I'd like to submit to you that it is actually statistically reasonable to assume that the person to your left has suffered that much too. And so has the person to your right. So the issue of loss and suffering is not only to experience it fully and to grieve it, but also to recognize that having suffered gives you x-ray vision into the suffering of others. And the glory is that storms pass. The glory is that the suffering ends. That's the meaning of the fact that Buddha had to leave his father's house and to see suffering for the first time, and it is that led him to his search for enlightenment. the Jews suffering, the Israelites suffering from slavery in Egypt, then being delivered from slavery, but having to suffer in their path through the desert for 40 years, and of course Jesus suffering on the cross. So human suffering is the ultimate, it's the religious factor, which is that this earth, that's what Buddha's main message was, that human experience is suffering. But the point even there is that in enlightenment, we transcend it. So the fact that you have ended a period of great loss and great suffering, you know, there's a part in the Course in Miracles, which I've always found very profound. It says, if you were down in a dungeon for many years, and then you were released, and you saw blue sky for the first time in many years, and you felt the sun on you and saw the sunlight for the first time in many years, and felt the breeze on your skin for the first time in many years, you wouldn't jump up and down all excited right away. In fact, you might even have some tears to cry. So knowing that you used to suffer and you suffer no longer, at the deepest level doesn't lead you to yeah. It leads you to a deep appreciation for the God who led you out of your suffering, and also a deep and sober and mature desire to be of service to those who suffer still. And then that's nothing you're telling anyone. It's a difference in who you are. The Course in Miracles says to teach is to demonstrate. You know, in the book of Thomas, Jesus says to his disciples, go out into the countryside and teach the gospel. Now, he did not mean go out into the world and hit other people over the head with our book. To teach metaphysically means to demonstrate. That is how we teach, by demonstrating. And the gospel is love. So in the book of Thomas, when Jesus says, go out into the countryside and teach the gospel, he meant go out into the countryside and be the presence of love. But something very interesting happens there. And they said, what do you mean just go out into the countryside? I mean, what will we say to people? And he said, I'll tell you when you get there. So the way you celebrate God, the way you testify, as it were, is by saying the thing that someone needs you to say at that moment. And you will know intuitionally. Prayer and meditation makes us finely tuned intuitional instruments. And sometimes it's a statement, sometimes it's a touch of the hand, sometimes it's a touch on the cheek, sometimes it's just the quality of your listening. You become so intuitionally attuned to how you might be in that moment of greater use. Does that make sense?
Yes.
Because that's what really matters now, that other people suffering end as yours did. Right? Anybody else? Okay, this lady over here.
Hi, Marianne. I'm not 100% sure exactly what my question
is. I didn't hear what you said, honey.
I'm not 100% sure exactly what my question is.
Okay.
But I'm an abortion doula, and I'm supporting women.
Did you say an
abortion doula? So supporting women through something that in society is such a deep, dark, secretive thing. And a lot of women think, you know, their karmic life after something like that, it's... I just wanted to hear your perspective on that issue.
I think it should be legal.
Mm-hmm.
I think it's an issue of conscience. I don't think the government should determine that decision. But I think that, and I don't know about Canada, but I know in the United States, for generations of women, it became far too casual a decision, and that many women have the psychic scars to prove it. And while I think it is should be legal, and while I have no judgment of anyone who comes to the point of feeling that's the decision that they must make, I think that any woman who makes that decision from any place other than the deepest reflection and prayer In my experience, I've never known a woman who made the decision casually. Whether it took her 10 years or 20 years or 30 years or 40 years, has not cried over having made that decision. So I would hope that part of your being that doula would be first and foremost supporting that woman in praying deeply about the decision. That's my belief.
I just want to say first, you are a true, true inspiration and such
Well, thank you. It takes one to know one.
I hope, and I honestly can only hope that myself and even a tenth of the women here can become a tenth of the powerful force that you are.
Oh, thank you. That's so kind.
It's so wonderful.
I just read the book for longer, you know?
Possibly. You said earlier about people who aren't awake, and that we don't need any more people who are awake, that we have the force already to move forward into this kind of new age of consciousness. And I'm wondering, how do you treat those who aren't awake then? How do you treat those who refuse to wake up and you?
Okay, well, this is very significant, because even when you first spoke, don't get me wrong, one of the shadows of the spiritual path is any sense of spiritual arrogance or spiritual superiority. So if you ever have a thought you're awake and somebody else isn't, pray to God to take away that spiritual superiority right now. Because that evil has been done on this planet and continues to be done by those who think they have God figured out, if only everybody else did. So the last thing we need is to be holding the space we're awake and others aren't. I know in my life and in the life of most people I know, some parts of me are awake and some parts of me are still asleep. So when I talked about an awakening, I meant as a general impulse. But you want to avoid any thought like I'm awake and somebody else isn't. You want to avoid any thought like we're awake, because there are people who think that about you and me. Traditional Christians who think we are so laboring in darkness here at these yoga retreat things, and they are praying for us. They are praying for us that we might see the light. So quite seriously, the last thing, we don't, you know, the world doesn't need more people who think we're awake and other people aren't. That's number one. So be very careful with thinking you're more awake than anybody else. Everybody is on a spiritual path. Some people, most people just don't know it. And everyone is as beloved of God as is everyone else. And the only way you could be even pointing out someone's ego is if you were in your ego. The part of me which would even see you is not awake, is unawake. Because if I was awake, I would only see how perfect you are, whether you see it or not. And that is how we awaken each other. We awaken each other by only relating to the awake in each other. The Course in Miracles says that's the meaning of the word charity. Charity is when I am around you assuming that you're actually more evolved than you are. We all have places where we're unawake, and we all have places where we are awake. That's the vast majority of us. I mean, there are some people, clearly, who are dwelling in a deep, deep spiritual sleep and darkness, and are what the Course in Miracles would call inaccessible to the power of the atonement. But that's not the that's not 99.9% of the people in the world. 99.9% of the people in the world, we're walking our path and doing the best we can in a place, certain places we were awake, and certain places we had issues with our parents or whatever, right? So we're making it, and that's the thing. So being awake means, to be awake by definition means that I am capable of seeing your perfection. If I am truly awake, I don't even see that within you, which is unawake. And in the presence of being in it, when you are in my presence and I only see the awake in you, you awaken. That's why the miracle worker, the Course says, is someone who extends our perception. This goes back to Pollyanna. The miracle worker, and a miracle is a shift in perception from fear to love. So it's shifting on the level of cause so that there will be a shift on the level of effect. So the miracle is when you are willing to extend your perception beyond the what your physical senses reveal to you to what your heart knows to be true. So you speak to the awakened someone. I mean, think about this in common sense, practical terms. Who do you behave well around? Someone who expects you to behave well, or someone who's just waiting for you to trip up? Because someone just waiting for you to trip up, you're more likely to trip up around them. And people who really expect the best in you, you rise. This is why people have a problem in long-term relationships. Because if I wake up in the morning and I'm with someone who takes every opportunity to remind me of the mistakes I made yesterday, that's not the person I want to be around. I want to be around someone who didn't even know about those mistakes. But the real power of relationship is to be around someone who knows that you made them, but is so merciful that that's not what their focus is on. They see the purpose of the relationship, because which is the purpose of relationships, they are laboratories of the soul. They are those places of maximal growth opportunity. That's what intimacy is. When you do see, if you haven't seen somebody's darkness, you haven't seen who they are. You don't know who that person is, but if you haven't forgiven somebody's darkness, you don't know what love is. So what intimacy is where you realize that because this is relationship is for healing purposes, our wounds will come up. I will see yours, you will see mine. The ego will go, ugh, I'm gone. The spirit will say, in the presence of non-judgment and mercy and compassion and ownership, this is where we will heal. So you want to stay away from I'm awake and you're not, whether it's with one person or with anyone in the world. Because like I said, you can't be awake and think that. Does that make sense? Is this okay that I'm, I don't know, is this okay that I'm still doing this? I don't know what time, is it okay? Okay, is it okay? With you, I don't know what I'm supposed to do. Okay,
hi.
You, I'll try to go a little quicker with my responses because I don't know what the time you wanna, yeah, okay, yes.
My question is, well, as we're on this path of enlightenment, you said earlier that enlightenment is an unlearning.
Yes, that's what the Course says, it is an unlearning.
So within this neoliberal and capitalist society, what does that unlearning look like?
Ma'am, I'm so sorry, I didn't hear you.
That's okay, I can be louder. In this neoliberal and capitalist society, Neoliberal.
Neoliberal capitalist society, okay, got it.
What does unlearning look like?
Oh, well, the problem, I'm not a Canadian, I'm an American, I'm a citizen of the United States, but I certainly know what has happened in my country. And that is that capitalism has swerved from its ethical center. So you can't, some people say that capitalism is inherently unethical. I don't actually believe that. But it has swerved from its ethical center. Adam Smith, who is one of the founders of the whole philosophy, said free market capitalism cannot exist outside an ethical center. The point with capitalism is, like everything else in the material world, it is what people do with it. So capitalism has developed, certainly in my country, in such a way that short-term economic gain for huge corporate, usually multinational corporate forces, is the economic bottom line. That is, by definition, unaligned with goodness, truth, holiness, and beauty, which is what we are here to do. If we see the purposes of economics, I mean, there's nothing holy about breadlines. There's nothing holy about what happens when money stops circulating. So the idea with economics, and this goes back to what I was saying before about how we should be the biggest grown-ups in the society, not the biggest, we should not be infantilized. Questions of economics, those of us in the transformational community should be very much weighing in on issues of economics and society. Now, some people in the transformational community from the most mature perspective would say capitalism is inherently off. Some would say it's not. But the point is, can economics, whether you see it in terms of capitalism or not, can economics be a conduit for justice? Economic justice is a moral issue. And it is a profound moral issue in our time. You have 1 billion people on the planet living on roughly $1.25 and less a day. That's called the bottom billion. Then you have another billion right on top of that living on $2 and less a day. So what does enlightenment mean? Enlightenment always means the precedence of love. It always means love being the bottom line. And money can be used to increase opportunity. Economics can absolutely be a conduit for greater justice, greater opportunity, greater creativity in people's lives. It absolutely can be. But we also know that money and economics in the hands of the ego can be a very destructive force. Does that make sense?
Hello.
Yes.
I just want to thank you so much for loving with conviction as you do. I think it's very clear that you do that. And as someone who wants to be a spiritual teacher or live this life, I want your greatest piece of advice of how to truly love with conviction.
The Course in Miracles says, your problem is not that you do not love. Your problem is that you do not love only. So I'm sure that you love. We all have enlightened moments. All of us do. And if you are even here at a weekend like this, that means you are already called to a more heart-centered existence. But we are all wounded as well. I'm not an enlightened master. I'm not someone who's completely healed in all areas. I'm just a whole lot better than I used to be. And that's what we want to remember, that the word try in A Course in Miracles is not a bad word. So I do not think, The Course in Miracles says it is not possible to exit the realm of egocentric consciousness without a teacher. But The Course in Miracles talks about the internal teacher, capital I, capital T. First of all, the issue is to find your spiritual path. The transformational community is filled with a lot of spiritual dilettantes. Jesus, Buddha, Muhammad, Moses, they didn't just spend the day, you know, making share graphics. You know, it takes more than just a few cool principles here and a few principles there. And it's just like yoga. Yoga, if you're going to do yoga, this means an actual practice, usually a daily practice. It's a very serious practice whereby you are training your muscles. It's no different. And spiritual exercise, like physical exercise, you never get to stop. You never get to look at yourself in the mirror and go, I like that. I don't have to exercise anymore. I don't do yoga anymore because I like the way I look now. With your thought forms, just like with your physical muscles, after a certain age, if you're not keeping them up, they're headed down. Because gravity will bring your muscles down. It will make them weak and flabby. Gravity will also take your thought forms down and make them weak and flabby. The Course in Miracles says you achieve so little because you have an undisciplined mind. And because we live in a planet where the consciousness of the human race is dominated by fear, we're constantly tempted into the judgmental thought, into the defensive thought, into the angry thought, into the thought that posits us as separate from others, which means that I'm better, no, I'm worse, I'm better, no, I'm worse, leads us to believe that we have to compete because of scarcity. So as we hone our spiritual, so the first answer to your question is to find your path. Many people in this room know what your primary spiritual path is. You just may or may not walk it. Some people say, you know, I don't really know. I don't know. I kind of like Buddhism. I kind of like Course in Miracles. I kind of like the Kabbalah. I don't know which. Some of you actually know, you're just not doing it. Some of you, if you don't know and you say a little prayer inside, I promise you books will fall at your feet within days. And then it's like some people, you know, it's like some people pay the dues at the gym, they just don't go. That's how some people are about spiritual paths. They know which one and they go to a lecture every once in a while. But to be serious in the way you're saying, it's daily spirit. It's no different than yoga or any other physical or nutrition or anything. It's about daily practice to hone. You want to hone your attitudinal muscles. Because, and remember that part I told you about in the morning. We are living in a world where the stress of the planet and the chaos of the times in which we live, the temptation to fear is so great, it takes practice. And we begin to see that every situation is practice. How was I? You know, you end your day with, how was I? Well, I could have been kinder in that moment. I could have been more compassionate in that moment. You atone, and you just build your spiritual strength. Now, as far as being a teacher is concerned, The Course in Miracles says that all of us are teachers and all of us are students. So this whole idea of being a spiritual teacher is, careful with that one. You're the faucet, you're not the water. And so you're not the generator of spiritual wisdom. You know, the way, it's counterintuitive. The way to be, to manifest to others as a leader is to think of yourself as a follower. You know? The way to manifest to others as someone who has something to say is to know that you of yourself have nothing to say. The way to navigate most powerfully the material plane is to know that you are not of the spiritual plane. Now, as you deepen, you know, the way to go horizontal, the way to have power horizontally, is to cultivate your power vertically. In both the Christian cross and the Jewish Star of David, what you have are visual symbols of the intersecting poles. And so you want to be someone, in the Course in Miracles, in referring to Jesus, it says, he lived on the earth, but thought only the thoughts of heaven. Heaven is not a condition or a place, but an awareness of oneness. Hell is what the ego would make of every moment. It's not something after you die. It's anxiety, depression, fear, and so forth. Now, to live on the earth but think only the thoughts of heaven means you want to be grounded in your body, yoga, nutrition, and so forth. But you want your mind to be centered on the realization that something more is going on here than what the physical senses perceive. Don't worry about how you're going to teach that to anyone else. Everything you do demonstrates how you're doing. And in that sense, quote unquote, spiritual teaching, if some of you thinks I'm supposed to be in business, you are a spiritual teacher as a business person, or you are a spiritual teacher as a doctor or a nurse or healer, or a spiritual teacher as an artist, or a spiritual teacher as anything else. Spirituality is not some separate category of our existence. It is the underlying ground on which we seek to stand. So, you know, it's like concepts like spiritual teacher. You know, in the East, the guru never calls him or herself guru. Spiritual teacher is something that others should use to describe you, but the true spiritual teacher never describes themselves that way. And for that reason, does that make sense? Yes.
Hi, Marianne. This question is actually coming from a sister in the audience, and she wants to know why you think infertility is at a rise. So that's question number one.
Why I think what?
Infertility is at a rise.
Infertility.
Yeah. And then the second question is, can we share this? Can we have the rights to share this to the masses?
Yeah. You mean like put it on YouTube or something?
Yeah.
Yes.
Okay, great. And then my third question is, can you leave us with three or more tangible tools where we can really apply this into our lives for some serious transformation?
You know, I'm having, the acoustics are hard for me. Say that one again.
Can you leave us with three or more tools for transformation?
Can I leave you? What have I been doing over the last hour and a half? I've been dancing on the table here.
These are texts that I'm getting right now.
Did you just, what?
I said these are texts that I'm getting. Can you ask her?
You know, I love how everybody wants enlightenment in three simple steps.
We want it fast.
Infertility. First of all, we have clearly polluted our air, we have polluted our food, we have polluted our earth, we have polluted our water. And so clearly something is very, very awry with the physical environment. That's number one. Number two, too many people aren't getting any. And that is because, students, take notes. There is something off in the masculine and feminine dynamic in many, many cases. I'm doing a seminar called the Aphrodite Training. I hope women, this is a women's seminar about this. You know, Greek goddesses, I'm fascinated by Athena and Aphrodite. And Athena is the goddess of production and manifestation and going out into the world and making things happen. But she's also a virgin goddess. And Aphrodite is the goddess of love and romance and sex and so forth. And over the last few years, even though I certainly consider myself a feminist, there is a kind of strain of flawed feminism whereby many women have suppressed the feminine in the name of feminism. And Aphrodite is like trapped light, and she's the juicier woman. And something has dried up too much in our culture. So I believe that there are external reasons, but I also believe that there are some internal reasons. And I think that some of the people who are doing the greatest work on this are working on it both from an external and an internal perspective.
Hi, Marianne. I wanted to ask you, what is the greatest way that we can empower our children and the children we work with?
I think that parents are the primary spiritual teachers. The first thing we can do is remember that. And as we become, you know, if we as a civilization may taking care of all children on the planet before the age of 8, the bottom line, making sure that children before the age of 8 everywhere were given what they needed to thrive, we would live on an entirely different planet, right? You know, when I was growing up, my mother was a very traditional housewife, and her whole entire world was her husband and her children and her home. And I grew up in that wave of feminism where I thought my mother's life was not important enough. It wasn't meaningful enough. I wanted to go out in the world and do something important. And it took me decades to realize how wrong I was. First of all, if you understand things metaphysically, there is no out there. And also, the more you learn about divine feminine and so forth, if the divine feminine is anything, she is the protector of children and the protector of the home. So my mother archetypally had it correct, and I think that women of our generation are called upon. You know, there is no divine feminine unless she's channeled through real woman. And anybody who's even thinking of concepts like the divine feminine who doesn't recognize the priority of children and home to the divine feminine is in some newfangled idea of divine feminine, which has a lot of cut velvet and dancing under the moon, but very little to do with the actual dynamic force of the divine. And so in that sense, my mother was right. It's just that our generation has evolved to realize that every child on the planet is one of our children, and the earth itself is our home. And so as we do that, not only as parents of small children, but as a society, some people are not called to have biological children, but to be mature, to be socially mature and spiritually mature, whether you yourself have children or not, you see the care and the protection of the young as the basic bottom line for the functioning of a society. And when your intention is that, then your intention is aligned with the ultimate intention of God or nature. And then I remember years ago, long before I had a child myself, I was giving, some women had asked me if I would do a mother's support group. And I remember praying and meditating before it started and saying, God, what can I tell these women? I don't have a child. What do I tell them? And I got this, what my spiritual answer that I felt was, your job is merely to remind them that they are the primary spiritual teacher. That's what's important. Number one, what we demonstrate to our children. Number two, the attention that we give to them. You know, our generation sometimes spends more time complaining about the way we think our parents messed up than actually addressing the small children who are going to suffer even worse than we did because we're not even thinking about them. And so we're not doing so well ourselves. And, you know, I also want to say, is anybody in this room, any woman in this room have children 5 or under? To you, I would like to say, you know all this stuff I say about how we need to address the starving children of the planet, and we have to address the environment, and we have to address the bottom billion, all that stuff I say about all the things we have to do? Not you. You are absolved. You're doing the most important job. You know, the Jesuit said, give me a child until he's 5 and he's mine. I regret every moment I spent away from my daughter before the age of 5. Because before the age of 5, every single thing, everything you say, everything you do, is put in there. After 5, you're still the primary voice and factor, but you're competing with some things. By the time that the eye-rolling years get here around 13, good luck. So I think that we have a lot of work to do in terms of creating societies which support women and men in placing primacy on our role as parents. And when you just have that level of very mature and very serious dedication to our children, once you're aligned with that, Spirit will tell you everything you need to know. It's like when Jesus said, I'll tell you when you get there. You'll know what to say, you'll know what to do. And it's all in you. It's like mother's milk. It's in you as soon as you realize that that's why you're on the earth. Okay. I see somebody coming, but I see just 2 more. Should we just do those 2 more? Yes, those 2 more. Okay.
Thank you, Marianne, for your beautiful presence.
Thank you.
And your commitment to humanity, thank you. to the children. You come at an auspicious time. We have a federal election coming up.
I hear that.
In 2 weeks. So given your personal experience in politics, could you please speak to bringing the spiritual community and the political communities together?
Well, I feel very strongly about it. I ran for Congress in the United States.
No.
I did. I feel that our citizenship, you know, I was saying all of us are assigned. Some are assigned to the arts, some of us are assigned to business, some of us are assigned to sciences and so forth. All of us are assigned to citizenship. And particularly, as I said earlier, those of us in the advanced democracies, the advanced societies, civilizations of the world, we make all the difference in many, many ways. And I think that we should see our citizenship as definitely a part of the extension of our sacred activism on the planet. I think that it is an aspect of maturity. And when I spoke before about the transformational community sometimes allowing itself to be infantilized, you simply cannot say that it doesn't matter when you actually look at the decisions, the huge amounts of money, the ways that certain social, political, and economic policies absolutely affect people's lives and either cause human suffering directly or indirectly. So I feel very strongly that, if you look at someone like a Gandhi, someone like a Martin Luther King, arguably two of the greatest political lights of the 20th century, and they came from a spiritual basis in their sense of the purpose of their political activism. So, and I also feel, and I, when people say they don't vote, I think voting, there's a feeling to it. You participated, and the universe sees that you participated. You know, the universe registers whether or not you're a player. So I feel very strongly about it, and Canada is obviously an important country. You know, the North American continent is important. This is big stuff. Advanced democracies are big. This is a big deal. And I certainly don't have any level of deep knowledge of Canadian politics like I do American, but I've heard enough to know that you have at least one person who has been compared at times to George Bush, and I...
We won't say any names.
Certainly hope that I would wish for you what I wish for us, which is we got rid of that guy. No credit to us, the Constitution said he couldn't run again. I don't know, I just know whoever you feel strongly about, and all jokes aside, because like I said, I really don't know, and I don't claim to know, but what I do feel strongly about is that our role as citizens is an important aspect of our role as cells in the psychic immune system, and if what I just said was an incorrect analogy, then please forgive me, because it's not my job to weigh in on Canadian politics. I'm just weighing in on the idea that our being responsible citizens is part of our being mature adults. Yes, ma'am.
I don't do this, so you know. Pardon? I don't do this, I don't speak in front of crowds. So you know I really want an answer to this question. So you say our greatest fear is not that we're inadequate, or it's that we're great beyond measure.
Yes.
So I've been seeking my whole life, as I'm sure a lot of these people are, meditation, yoga, breath work, and anytime I get deep into a practice, I panic, I freak out, I stop, I get an ego and fear. How do we overcome that fear of becoming great?
Now, wait a minute. You're saying if you do the Course in Miracles, let's say, have you ever done the Course?
I've read a bit on it, but then I stop. Something gets in the way and I freak out and I stop. And then I'll come back to it and then I freak out. And then I stop.
So you know my answer? Stop. How old are you?
I am 34.
Stop. Stop. Just give it up. The world is too important. Life is too important. You know, it's sad when a child doesn't have the experience of being a child, but it's also sad when an adult doesn't have the experience of being an adult. We all make choices. We all make choices. And at a certain point, like they say in AA, you get sick and tired of being sick and tired. If you're doing this ditzy thing, you're getting something out of it. So the greatest service that I and the rest of us in the room can be to you is to not in any way be enrolled in the thought that you're not a choice in the matter. And to know that we're not entertained by it, and that there's something not good enough for you in it. And if you're talking about something like the Course, you're talking about one sentence you look at a day. That's all you're talking about. It's just a game you play with yourself. You don't freak out any more than anybody else freaks out. Whatever that little drama that you've drawn for yourself, it's not worthy of you. You are a serious woman. You are in your 30s. You are a daughter of God. And God needs to use you for great and glorious purposes. Let that call to you. And let that childishness drop and dissolve in the presence of the grandeur that is your function on this earth. All right, okay, I got one more. Just one. You got to be quick because they're going to come and drag me off stage. One more, yes, quick.
Marianne, thank you very much for sharing your thoughts with us tonight.
Thank you.
And my question is around, what are your thoughts on learning from an unborn child?
And what about an unborn child?
Learning.
Learning from an unborn child.
Yeah, I'm reading a book, it's called The Secret Life of an Unborn Child. And I'm just really curious how I can learn from my unborn baby, and once the baby is born, how I can learn from him and be together on our spiritual journey.
You know, words are at best but concepts. You're pregnant? Be pregnant. Drink tea. Put your feet up. Play music for the baby. Enjoy yourself. This whole the last thing you need to do is load yourself with concepts. Because the greatness of this experience is beyond the concept. Trust me, once they get old enough, they'll teach you plenty. Okay! Thank you! Thank you, thank you, thank you! Let's say one final prayer. Thank you, thank you, thank you. Thank you, thank you so much. Lovely being with you, Edmonton. Thank you. Thank you. And let's all join in this extraordinary moment in blessing all those who have hosted this weekend, sending a blessing to all those who have worked hard to make this happen, and sending our love to everyone else who is here, and praying in our own way that we become the people that Spirit would have us be, that we might do as Spirit would have us do. And now together, may we go forth in confidence and go forth in peace. For there are angels to your left and there are angels to your right. There are angels in front of you and angels behind. There are angels above you and angels below. Whoever you meet, greet with love. Salute the love in them that exists as it exists in you. In all moments of temptation, may we choose to forgive. And in this moment, we send our love to every sentient being in this universe and beyond. May we be filled. May a great elixir of liquid light enter in through the top of our head, travel down through all of the organs, all of the muscles, all of the bones, the skin, every aspect of who and what we are. May this elixir of light fill every thought, every aspect of past, present, or future. And may this light extend outward beyond our skin, beyond our bodies, to unite us with all beings. May we thus be healed. Where we have been weak, may we now be strong. Where we have been enchained, may we now be freed. Where we have been huddled in fear, may we now be released by love. May this miracle occur in us, that miracles might now occur through us, that a world of sorrow might turn to a world of joy, a world of fear might transform into a world of love. Dear God, may these miracles occur, and in any way you choose, use us. And so it is, together, we all say, amen. God bless you, Edmonton, thank you so much. Thank you. God bless you, everybody. Love you guys, thank you.